السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين، أما بعد. سورة الممتحنة، السورة رقم 60 في القرآن الكريم، لها من أسباب نزولها سبب عظيم. سورة الممتحنة، سورة نمبر 60 in the Mus'haf. This surah has reasons of revelation, occasion of revelation. And it's a, subhanAllah, يعني a great incident or a great event. سورة الممتحنة, the word الممتحنة refers to the woman who was tested. It means she that was examined or tested. It is named after a woman who was tested. Who was that woman that was tested or examined? And the surah was revealed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam because of her, and the surah is named after the title that was given to this woman. There was a man in Mecca, his name was Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt. And Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt was one of the enemies of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was one of the people that harmed him all the time. He was one of the people that put the insides of the slaughtered goat or a sheep or an animal on the head and the body of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam while he was praying and making sujood, and was the one also that got like a piece of cloth and choked or tried to suffocate the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam until he fell unconscious. Anyway, he was such a very evil person that harmed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the most, all the way. There was no exception for this man. Nothing else was left to do. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brings out from this man a woman. His daughter, her name was Umm Kulthum bint Uqbah ibn Abi Mu'ayt. She reverted to Islam early, but she was very smart. She did not declare her reverting to Islam and did not talk about it a lot. She was worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, trying her best to protect herself, because she knew that if her family knew about it, they were going to put her in too much trouble. That's why she tried her best to protect herself, worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, get closer to him. And she was not that old. She was 16 or 17 years old. Very young women, subhanallah. She tried in the beginning to migrate with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam when he migrated to Medina. But it did not go through. She couldn't make it. Then later on, after Al-Hudaybiyah, we're talking about 6 years after the hijrah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam concluded what is known as the Treaty of Al-Hudaybiyah with Quraysh. And one of the conditions of this treaty was that anyone comes from Quraysh to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, It's the responsibility of Muhammad to return him to Quraysh. And anyone comes from the Muslim side to Quraysh, it's not the responsibility of Quraysh to return him. And we know this condition was considered as unjust and unfair condition in the sight of the Muslims. But subhanAllah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had accepted all the conditions in order to save the lives of the people and to have a chance to spread Islam. There will be no war, there will be no fight, no conflict between them and Quraysh. They will have enough time to spread the da'wah and to talk to the people about Islam. So anyway, the Prophet ﷺ accepted all these conditions. And this condition was very clear. Anyone comes from Quraysh to the Muslims, they have to return. This Umm Kulthum radiallahu ta'ala anha tried many times to migrate, but it was not easy for her. Until after this Sulh al-Hudaybiyah, now she decided to migrate. And many people proposed to get married to her in Mecca because she was from a noble family and she was really a good woman, good young woman, but she did not accept any one of them. And she preferred to migrate by herself. Imagine a woman, 16 or 17 years old, migrating by herself from Mecca to Medina. And it is reported that she was the first woman to migrate to Medina after the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there are some men that migrated also. But as far as the women, she was the first one to migrate from Mecca to Medina after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam migrated with the other Muslims. She went from Mecca to Medina walking. You can imagine, and you can see the distance between Mecca and Medina and how long it is. We get tired in the bus sometimes when we travel from Mecca to Medina or from Medina to Mecca. She migrated from Mecca to Medina walking on her feet until she reached Medina and went to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now her family sent some people to bring her back, because according to the agreement, she has to come back. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to do that because he wants to abide by the condition. But subhanallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved this woman and the other women who migrated, and they were going to face the same situation, because if she went back to Mecca, there was going to be a big problem to her. It is actually jeopardizing her life, and it's a big threat for her life. Let's put it this way. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down this ayah from Surah Al-Mumtahina, in which he says, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, idha ja'akumul mu'minatu muhajiratin famtahinuhunna, الله أعلم بإيمانهن فإن علمتموهن مؤمنات فلا ترجعوهن إلى الكفار. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in this ayah what it means. O believers, when the believing women, the mu'minat, make migration to you, they migrated to Medina. إذا جاءكم المؤمنات مهاجرات, then test their faith and their belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had tested her faith and her belief in Allah. قَالَ وَاللَّهِ مَا أَخْرَجَكُنَّ إِلَّا حُبُّ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. حُبُّ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهُ. He tested them by asking them, do you testify by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that nothing brought you from Mecca to Medina except the love of Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? And she testified to that, wallahi ma akhrajaha illa hubbullahi wa rasuluh, illa hubbullahi wa rasulih. Nothing got her out of Mecca and made her take all this journey to Medina except the love of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, his religion, and his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah said to his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, فَامْتَحِنُوهُنَّ فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُوهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ. If you find that they are true believers in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but Allah said something in the ayah, وَاللَّهُ أَعْلَمُ بِإِيمَانِهِنَّ. And Allah knows that they are true believers. فَإِنْ عَلِمْتُمُوهُنَّ مُؤْمِنَاتٍ. If you know that they are true believers in Allah Azza wa Jal, فَلَا تَرْجِعُوهُنَّ إِلَى الْكُفَّرِ. Do not return them to the disbelievers, because it is going to put their life in danger. Do not return them to the disbelievers. فَلَا تَرْجِعُوهُنَّ إِلَى الْكُفَّرِ. And based on this ayah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not return this woman, Umm Kulthum bint Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam did not return her to Mecca. And she remained in Medina. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning, she got married to Zayd ibn Haritha. And we know who was Zayd ibn Haritha radiallahu ta'ala anhu. He was the adopted son of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Or in the beginning, he was actually a slave. And she was from a noble family. And she said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, my family, he came from this family, and he want me to get married to Zayd ibn Haritha. She was kind of hesitant in getting married to him. But Allah sent down this ayah from the Quran, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ. It is not for a believing man or a believing woman when Allah decides something that they will have their own decision. They have to follow the decision of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She had to abide by this rule. And she had to follow Allah's decree. And Zayd ibn Haritha, as we know, was martyred in the Battle of Mu'ta. Then after that, she was honored by getting married to Abdurrahman ibn Auf. First to Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam radiallahu ta'ala anhu. And then after that, to Abdurrahman ibn Auf. And Abdurrahman ibn Auf and Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam were two of the 10 companions that were given the good news of entering Jannah. Min al-Ashra al-Mubashshareena bil-Jannah. And Abdurrahman ibn Auf was one of the wealthiest Muslims in Medina. And he, in the beginning, migrated, left everything behind him in Mecca, and started from the scratch in Medina and became one of the wealthiest people in Medina, subhanAllah. And after the death of Abdurrahman ibn Auf, she got married to Amr ibn al-As, radiallahu ta'ala anhu. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent down this ayah from Surah Al-Mumtahina regarding this woman who had taken this long trip, this long journey from Mecca to Medina, had done her best for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and for the sake of Islam. And because of this, Allah honors her by sending down this surah that is named after her title, and it is being recited by the Muslims, and by the Prophet ﷺ, and by the Muslims all the way until the day of judgment. That's how Allah Azza wa Jal defends the believers, as he says in the Quran, إِنَّ اللَّهَ يُدَافِعُ عَنِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إن الله لا يحب كل خوان كفور. And someone might ask why the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did not abide by this condition of returning her to Mecca. You will see that Quraysh also started breaking all the conditions and the covenant of Al-Hudaybiyah, and they also abide by all the conditions, and they started playing with this treaty for their own benefit, as far as harming Bani Khuza'a, the tribe that joined the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and so many other things happened. So there were some reasons that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, number one, had to follow Allah's command. She says, test them, and if you find them believers, do not return them to Mecca. Secondly, that it's a kind of treatment to Quraysh, that was equal to their treatment of the Prophet ﷺ and the Muslims when they started breaking the conditions and the terms of the and violating all the terms of the Sulh al-Hudaybiyah or the Treaty of al-Hudaybiyah. As we see, if there were men that helped, supported the Prophet ﷺ and sacrificed so many things in their life for the sake of Allah and for the sake of Islam, we see also women that had sacrificed every there and near for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, مَنْ عَمِلَ صَالِحًا مِنْ ذَكَرٍ أَوْ أُنْثَى وَهُوَ مُؤْمِنٌ فَلَنُحْيِيَنَّهُ حَيَاةً طَيِّبَةً وَلَنَجْزِيَنَّهُمْ أَجْرَهُمْ بِأَحْسَنِ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Which means, whoever acts righteously, whether a male or a female, and believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we will give them, grant them the best life in this world and in the hereafter, and Allah will reward them with the best. Subhanallah. And she died as a great female companion of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, narrating a hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. One of the main lessons that we learn is, it's not necessary if the parents are not good that their children will be bad like them, and vice versa, it's not necessary that if the parents are good that their children will be like them. Everyone is responsible for himself. The responsibility of the parents is to teach, educate their children and to try their best to make them good Muslims, and by the end of the day, guidance comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we see examples in the prophets and the messengers, such as Prophet Nuh alayhi salatu wasalam, and how his son went against him and he was a prophet, and his own wife went against him when he was a prophet, and Prophet Lut alayhi salatu wasalam, same thing. Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam, his own uncle that was guarding, protecting him, did not even say the shahada. So it's not a general rule that as long as the parents or the grandparents or the ascendants are good, so the descendants will be the same. It is all in the hand of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We should do our job, leave the results up to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is Uqba ibn Abi Mu'ayt, was the worst person ever, subhanallah. Died as a disbeliever in Allah azza wa jal, was even killed in the battle of Badr. And he died as a disbeliever in Allah Azza wa Jal. But look at his daughter and how much she sacrificed for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is one of the main lessons that we learn. And also we learn how Allah honors those who sacrifice every day and near for the sake of Allah Azza wa Jal by revealing Quran and surahs of the Quran that is named after their title. Like this surah, which is known as Surah Al-Mumtahina. نسأل الله سبحانه وتعالى أن ينفعنا بذلك وأن يجعلنا جميعا من الذين يستمعون القول فيتبعون أحسنه. اللهم إنا نسألك الهدى والتقى والعفاف والغنى ومن العمل ما ترضى برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا واستر عيوبنا واشرح صدورنا وبلغنا مما يرضيك آمالنا. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في الدنيا والآخرة. اللهم إنا نسألك العفو والعافية في ديننا ودنيانا وأهلينا وأموالنا. اللهم استر عوراتنا وآمن روعاتنا. اللهم احفظنا من بين أيدينا ومن خلفنا وعن أيماننا وعن شمائلنا ومن فوقنا، ونعوذ بعظمتك اللهم أن نغتال من تحتنا. وصل اللهم وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك، أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت، أستغفرك وأتوب إليك. والعصر، إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. جزاكم الله خيرا.